wholeness and balanced vibrations to everyone, and thank you for tuning in to the 2012 show. Today we are going to have an awesome show, and we're going to talk about, well, the title of today's show is Angelic Disclosure. Of course, today is March the 11th, 2012. We're speeding along. We're on the master number day. We're definitely going into Aries strong. And I'm just going to ask any caller in the chat box to notify me if whether or not they can hear me clear, and then we can begin today's show. So I'm just asking someone to type in the chat box, I can hear you clear, and then we can get things started. Okay, great. So today's show, like I said, is going to be massive, but first I wanted to go ahead and introduce my panel. I know Luis will be calling in soon, and I'm also going to introduce Wes and Crystal. I'm going to let them talk and say hello to everyone now. That way they don't have to come in later on. Let me open up that line. Here we go. And Wes, can you hear me out there in Canada? The time zone has definitely changed. Okay, I'm not getting any feedback yet from Wes.
I can hear you, my friend.
Yep. All right.
I'm here.
All right, just wanted to make sure you're in. And we're going to go ahead and get things started today. I'm going to get revved up. Of course, today's show is going to be a deeper conversation. It's definitely a depth conversation. That's what I was talking to Wes about before the show. That's just, you know, taking a couple breaths and letting myself understand that my obligation and our obligation at the Resistance is to inform people about what's happening. And this goes beyond duality and fear. So while we may not think about causing duality and fear by our conversation, sometimes we may get information that may cause individuals to do that. So then the next question is that do you give people that information? And I would tell you at this point, you know, this is 2012. This is also the 2012 show. My name is James Bomar. I wrote the code of the Matrix. So if anyone is on this live, I feel they should have enough of that kind of information to be able to stomach this. And I'm sure that they've probably come to much of this conclusion anyway, because if it's the truth, we should find it redundified everywhere. So before I get into the more of the serious part of the conversation today, I want to talk about smiling, because I had the thought the other day about who is really the happiest person in the world. You know, it's funny because people often search for the richest person in the world, and they go to Google, who is the richest person in the world? But they never say, well, who is the happiest person in the world? And I think that we should probably find the happiest people in the world and really start to supplement ourselves with that kind of energy also, as we mix it up with this in-the-know information about what is exactly happening in our reality. So I will say that, once again, I was speeding through levels of consciousness, going higher in the vibration, and I was just barely holding on until I actually smiled because of something that I saw. And when I smiled, I felt the crown chakra open up even more. And now I realize why there was a mystery behind the other Buddha, the little sitting, fat, smiling Buddha. And they say, oh, the reason why he's smiling is because it opens up his crown chakra, not necessarily because he's happy. So the reality is that if you smile, that movement as a facial mudra opens up a lot of things. So remember to keep that smile on your face no matter what you're experiencing. Never let them take that smile off. Okay, so what we're dealing with here is we're dealing with the elves again. We're dealing with the Elohim again. Now something of such massive force that has propelled itself through the what I would say is the world's highest traffic book, the Bible. And now we're dealing with it again. So the word Bible, of course, comes from the term, from the word Byblos, which is an island on Crete, or a place in Crete. And that is known to be the seat of the cult of Isis. But in English, how it finally turns out, because everything is continuously evolving and turning into its cause and effect, so it comes out Bible as two bulls, meaning by, meaning two bull, meaning also the term Baal, also the term Baal from the Lord, meaning the Lord, and Baal meaning a bell in the church. So all of this connection between these entities and the church and spirituality in general is now coming to full revelation, meaning it's actually going to reveal itself, and it has been revealing itself. And people just don't know exactly what it means and what they're seeing and what they're hearing. So that's what we're going to do on today's show, is we're going to make it crystal clear of what these angelic forces really are, what they're up to, and how you tie into that. Because there is something that you will see within this book they call the Bible, and it talks about that when you meet someone, you should be careful to how you treat them, and you should always treat them very kindly, because many people have entertained angels. And when you look deeper into the Talmud in this scripture in Hebrew, it's worded a lot different. And what it actually says, when we translate it back into English, is that the angels themselves now look like humans. This is how it interprets in the Talmud, not from 1611, which was still missing about 200,000 words in the English language. When the Hebrew text and the Aramaic text that were being used and put into Old English, we now have upwards of 200,000 to 300,000 new words since then. So in many cases, they could not interpret what was written in Hebrew because we didn't even have the word yet. The English Gothic Germanic language was still putting itself together off the Futhark ruin. So basically, in interpreting a language that was already put together on a Merkaba system, or a full complete spiritual system, like a technology, which is what the Hebrew language is, even knowledge about the computer, etc., the cube, etc. So it was an incorrect, imperfect, distorted language was attempting to interpret an already perfected language. Okay, so imagine what ensued. So when you go back into these scriptures now and you interpret them, they mean something entirely different to how they've been interpreted now. And so what it was known is that, just as we talked about with Buddha seeing into the future and seeing that the gods had basically began to suffer physicality, although I don't know if that's suffering. I noticed how these negative words keep being inserted when things are explained. And I would suppose if we would remove all the negative emotional words from spiritual text, then we would get a lot closer to the truth and what's happening and to be able to understand it. So these gods came into physicality and began to look on the prototype of man. So it tells you that there were different kinds of men and women in these days. And I'll explain how this happened. Now, first, if you notice in the Bible, man is created twice. Just go, two different men are created. One is made from the breath of God, as they say, and the other one is made from the earth. So what they're saying is one is made from ethereal forces, while another one is purely coming from the earth itself and what the earth is generating. Now, with women, now you got man's story covered, okay? Two different kind of men. Woman's story is she comes from seven sisters. So the current woman we're talking about now, she has seven mothers, okay? And these seven mothers are different kind. You have Maya, you have even Isis now. So there's seven different ones, and that creates this spectrum of women. But over those seven, there is one eighth called the queen, the highest octave, the octopus, the octagon, all the transformation, infinity, all of that. So that's what stands over them. That is the collective, the hive mind, etc. The double side of the brain, as you can see with the eight, symbolizes two circles. Okay? So, and it's also SS, S front and S back. And so I'm going to show you how all this ends up connecting, because there's many different entities that are speaking to people now through what they're calling elf waves. They've actually named it properly. Kudos, finally they named something properly. The elf waves are what people feel are spiritual communication to them. Now, where it's coming from is an entirely different interpretation, but what you hear or what you feel or what you can divine, or whatever term you use, is coming through an elf wave. So, of course, when individuals know how to project elf waves themselves, now, first, of course, we could do that with our mind, through mind control, or to controlling your own mind, etc. Or it could be done through machinery, where the machine, you could type in a message in, and the machine will send the message out through an elf wave. So this is the whole mythology of also facts. stop Satan, Santa, and his elves, or his elf ways, the ones who carry out his messages, because, as they say, angels are messengers, okay? So how this plays out is, you always see, especially within technology and in the explanations of science, the recreation of exactly what the creators did to put this planet together. So they reintroduce it as if they've accomplished something, but reality is that they're only copying off of the original pattern. So with the elves, Venus and Jupiter, these two planets in conjunction, Sirius, this planet especially, there's been a lot of seeding in this planet of hybrids. So the hybrid angel human is amongst us and may be you. This is information that cannot be refuted. There was already a colonization. The queen, Maya, decided to propagate her seed. Meaning, there's a term that is used in deeper occult. It's called the Lord and the Lady. Remember these two terms, the Lord and the Lady, because there was already knowledge that within the center of the earth, in the place they call the pentagram, which is, just means the center of fire, the right inside of the earth, there was a being that was there that was probably closely connected with one of the first rays that penetrated, like I talked about on the last show, it penetrated that field of water or amniotic fluid. So it began to grow from within. So many people would say, well, that being is trapped there. This is what you find in mythology, that they say Satan is trapped in the center of the earth. But again, that word trapped is, once again, those negative things that make you then look for the good side and then make you figure out, you know, well, how long is it going to be trapped? And all of these questions that have nothing to do with exactly the statement. So that's why it's important to remove trap and just say, well, Satan is in the center of the earth. And he is it being worshipped. It has another female counterpart with it, which is why it's always depicted as androgynous. Like even the Baphomet symbol is an androgynous, because there is what's called the Lord and the Lady. So if you see, if you're logged in today on live stream, there's some pictures going through. And one of those pictures show you on the X-Men series, just recently the X-Men movie, the first one, actually, not the first one, the third one. Azazel and Isis, or the Ice Queen, are standing together because this is already known within the magical books of Britain. Do you not understand that if something is not working, then people put it away from them very fast? If it has no existence and it's not real, then people put it away from them very fast. But here we have 4,000, 5,000, 6,000 years, even up to 60,000 years worth of writing, especially about the Devas, in regards to the other beings that are here that are invisible to most humans, but not all humans. Because the human hybrids can see them because they have their biorhythm. So anything that you're on that biorhythm and on that frequency, you can see. This is why the reality to most people appears to be solid, because they are on that biorhythm or on that frequency. But when they start to adjust into a higher or lower one, this one dissipates. And the sensation either feels like you're falling or flying. Okay? When you're shifting through frequencies. Now, the shifting through frequency stuff is not new at all. What's happening now is that right now, in the day that we're living in, is that you, as an advanced human being with all the equipment to ascend and descend the universe, are being controlled because they are managing your access to your power and energy. That's what we're talking about here. I don't really want to get into who's on the right side and who's on the wrong side. Just want you to understand that because you don't have access to this energy that is inside of you and really functions, it shows you that there is a controller. What ensues from here is you just understanding who they are, why they control, and why it is necessary for you to bypass them. Meaning that you have to understand this kind of stuff in order to bypass it. It's like you have to have the directions to going through this. Like I said, man, we're going to make it through this. What you will be looking at is if you see a starfish, go and find a starfish and then turn it over, or find a video with a starfish and turn a starfish over, the pentagram. But in the center of the starfish, you will find the symbol of the black hole, which is where the starfish's mouth is. And this is why the ancient men said that they could go through Hades. Basically, even Jesus is recorded going through hell. Many people that are in the deeper text, in the Tibetan text especially, were recorded being able to surf the wormhole, for better lack of words, and then go out of this. Because the beings that live here have no intention of ending it. And many people know about this knowledge that I speak of, but what they joined is this side that they think is the good side. I mean, they joined this Jesus side, never realizing that Jesus is also the Nephilim. He is a son of God. He says he is. So what then becomes important to interpret is what is really going on. Like Kanye West says, I couldn't tell you what side Jesus is on in his first song, Jesus Walks. Just have to read these scriptures. Look at it again. You find Denzel Washington playing in the movie Fallen. Okay, God is on my side. He's chasing a guy who keeps having this, different people who keep having this being jump into them, and it makes them sing this song. Then it shows in the end of the movie that it goes into a black cat. But basically in the whole movie you see Denzel Washington's initiation. Now I have a picture up of him. He's playing around in the military and doing things with the military, just like in X-Men, as Azazel is doing things with the military. Okay? So what happens is that you then see another entire level of this, where the stars, the actors, are really involved in all of the necessary moves that are necessary just to keep the machination going, keep the machine going. As you see in the Animatrix series, you see this horse riding out, and it's mechanical. And then it just keeps going and going and going and going. This is the symbol of how we trudge through good and bad times. Ignorance sweeps over things for a while and makes everyone forget where they came from and who they were on subsequent lives and connections with biorhythms, the universe, etc. Then as the circle begins to turn and they get closer to their origin point, they start to realize everything all at once. The goal is, people, is that you have to guide yourself out of this. You have to span off into higher states of consciousness and begin to maneuver your own vehicle rather than continuously taking orders from the beings that have been giving the orders. The organism, the organization, the collective, as they call it. To get into higher expanses, you may have to leave this old mind state. And all the resistance has been doing continuously is showing you the methods of doing that. You have to clean yourself out internally. You have to understand the frequency spectrum by playing frequencies to yourself so you can tune your ears back from 1 to 20,000 hertz. You have to work on opening your cornucopic field. You have to practice astral projection. But this is if you want to attain it. Because you don't really have to do anything. If you don't do it, then it's virtually unobtainable without there being disasters. I have an entire list of the disasters. Meaning that as someone who's observing Earth myself, you could see where individuals have taken this energy, this power, and have lost themselves with it through more of boredom than anything. Meaning that once you do finally see that there is more, it doesn't mean that you become more. You can see more and totally not become it. How many people can we see that we think are on a higher level? Even from the wealthy level, you see people and they've accomplished this and you can see it, but that doesn't mean that you're wealthy. So don't mix up the two. So the reality shows us that to become something, you must know its inner workings first, and then you must make the trip. And now you must know all the inner workings and details of what you're trying to attempt. And then you must make that trip. Some people are still getting information about the entire field of what exactly is being placed before us. This is also what the resistance is here to do, to provide that information to you. So here's how it really works. You now see, as I posted the video in the chat box, the UN has planned, is now has taken over. They have now said, the U.S. has officially said that they answer to the UN now. And let me see if I can resource this link. It's already in the chat box, but I know for people who just came in, they may not see it. So let me just copy and paste it here. Copy. Okay, so the U.S. officially announces, and you'll find that in the Blog Talk Radio chat box, that they are under control of the U.N. because we've talked about this in the Code of Nations. The U.N. is run by the Theosophical Society and Madame Blavatsky. Now, Madame Blavatsky, along with the rest of them, are all in really a group called Sub Rosa, meaning under the rose. And in this case, the rose is Venus. And Venus in this term gets the term Lucifer. So Sub Rosa means under the control of Lucifer. And let me explain to you how this happens. What happens is that as you look at the stars in an altered state of consciousness, you can get mesmerized. It becomes very similar to what happens to the insect when it flies into the light and then it burns itself. There is something about just the nature of our spirit and our soul that when we look into these celestial lights, for a moment, at least, there is what's called spellbinding. You're like froze for a moment. And then, if your mind is strong enough, then you can shake it. And you gain all of the energy and information that was transmitted, because it's like a mirror. If you can see someone in the mirror, then they can also see you too. Remember that. So, anytime something has opened your mind, then its mind is open too. So it then becomes a transfer of information, but what's happened is many people have been entranced. Even the thing that we're calling the sun in the sky is a larger version of something that entrances larger beings. And that's what I was telling you I saw. Now I have a full explanation of what exactly I saw. When I looked and the sun was in full splendor, and there were beings locked in position around the sun that had wings, and they were just face like gazing into it and phase locked. Now, it's because what the magician does, and I figure there's a master magician running around here somewhere. What the magician is capable of doing is they're capable of actually bending the will of what we're calling the Nephilim. What now have become hybrid humans. Okay, this is why, what some people would say, well, how do the controllers really work? It's because the controllers don't have the same level of will that the ones that they're controlling doing. How would this would work is that the ones with this different kind of will would be easy to control. And let me show you. They would become basically, they could be hypnotized easy. And this is the same thing that John Lamb Lash was talking about with the Sharon lock. There's an area in the back in which the archons are staring there. And they do like a phase lock there. So the simplified version of that is that when the magician seeks to control these kind of beings, it's through the power of mesmerism and hypnosis. And because they're elementals, thus basically functioning on like a lower level of consciousness, but still very powerful, they can be controlled by the magician who does not have a problem with his or her will. Now, when you really look at that, because a person could look at that extrospective and think, well, okay, so that's what they're doing. But if you actually notice what I just said, you'll see that that is what's being done to Earth. That in humanity's state right now is very similar to elemental. Very elementary, pouting like kids, not handling problems, wasting, plastic, okay? So in that state, a magician can control you and has been controlling. Now, the magician or the chief magi, as it's called, would be a sun. Basically, when it would finally play out in our reality, it would look like a sun in the sky. And there would become a heavy dependency upon it. to make everything happen. And this is why even the ancient books, it says if you get into altered state of consciousness or you get into the high state of meditation, remember when I say altered state of consciousness, I don't mean drugs. I mean in the higher levels of the meditation. You can see the dragons pull the sun. That's what they say. And some people say, oh, that's crazy. That's mythology. You've seen dragons pull the sun. You can't see it if you don't have a third eye open. Then what you see, you'll see a cherub comes across the sky every day, and that's what it says. It put a cherub to protect the garden in the Bible, it says, so that no one could get in it. But they don't let you know that it's also so no one can get out of it. So the cherub is known as the vehicle of the God. And it is synonymous with the word dragon or behemoth, which is the Bohemian Grove. Those from that practice the Bohemian tradition. Okay? So I'm giving you every single key to what's happening in the reality so you can unlock it. You can walk out of this. There are individuals such as myself that have sacrificed many things to get this information to you, meaning that it takes dedication to this continuously to have all this kind of information in your mind and finally so that it clicks, so that you can give it to other people. And it's a gesture. It's one of the highest gestures that can be given here. So I'm telling you, take this information of what is going on this planet. Use your mind, body, and soul, and it understands how to calibrate a way around it and through it into your higher state of existence. You can grow from this experience of what an entire pantheon has put you through. You run the Olympic trials. That's why the last one now in this year's 2012 Olympic Games. Olympic Games are you. The heroes are here. The Olympians are here challenging you. You can now move beyond it because certain laws and systems have now been made aware to you. So we're going to leave it at that for this point. I'm going to welcome people calling in, asking more about this. This is very expansive. I have a lot of information on this. Like, I have so much information on proving that this is exactly what's going on. Definitely not from my only, just my personal experience, but also individuals that are also in the resistance and individuals abroad. Information that we've been allowed to get a hold of. Information that's never really been seen before. Tons of books that have never been read that have all been compressed into maybe 200 to 300 page documents explaining everything that's going on. So the only thing that is left is just getting this information to people in a format that is actually accessible and able to allow them to see visually and through all faculties exactly how this is going on, how they're involved. Because the other thing is that this is not a blame game anymore. This is not a game anymore. This is where you see how you're here. And then you will also see that not all beings that live here are negative. This is why the Bible itself is written by none other than Yahweh itself, meaning the Azazel being is the one who wrote the Old Testament. This name is also synonymous with SS. This name is synonymous with Allah. This name is synonymous with Sorak. Many of the different beings are all the same one when it comes to a certain kind of knowledge, especially that pentagram knowledge. Because the pentagram knowledge was not here on Earth, meaning people did not know about how Earth was made before. That's why they say the greatest thing that was ever caused for worse on the planet, as they say, some, and then another faction says for the better, was the knowledge of exactly how it was put together. Because if you notice in the book of Enoch, it says the angels taught them the phases of the moon. This means it taught them what the moon really does, how it pulls energy, how it pushes energy. It taught them the astrology and the moving of the stars. That means it taught them the zodiac and why they behave like they behave. Then it taught them the making, the forming, and the fashioning of the swords. So you can only see where that's led to. So all of this was given in the hands of beings that had a higher responsibility. And when it leaked into the hands of other beings, such as humans, that didn't feel like they had that responsibility, then, or to uphold the honor within those responsibilities, then all hell ensued. And thus, man has been stuck, man and woman, have been stuck in a hell-like dimension, or a Helen-type dimension, which means just a kill, okay? A bump. And so this is what you have the opportunity to know. You have the opportunity to get this information to really investigate on your own. You can see how even companies like Maersk, who is the largest shipping magnate in the world, are elves themselves. They use the elven star, which is the seven-pointed star, meaning you have two extra appendages on top, which is wings. You will see how the dolphin connects in with this. The dolphin is something else. It's a much more advanced spirit. You have to start thinking about other beings. Because dolphins are mammals, even though they live in the water. Many of the things that live in the water are still mammals. So just because you live on land doesn't make that be the key reason on why you're a mammal. A lot of people think, if they don't think about the mammary, they think about the mammary gland sometime and taking milk and live birth. However, they exclude that from the sea because they see the sea like it's squiddy and reptilian-like, and so they don't think mammals are in the sea. But the reality is that there are advanced mammals, whales, known as behemoths, that have a higher state of consciousness because their brains and their dimensions, okay? But they're still here. They say most of the undiscovered things are still in the ocean. Okay, that's great. I'm glad they're getting a little further. But it's also in the geometry of the things in the ocean. Let's finish it off. And much of what you see on land came from the ocean. It has an ocean correspondence. Seahorse, trees, coral, everything. Snakes, everything. And this is why Darwin wasn't, when he put the theory of evolution, that was the finishing of the work for the donations that he received to do it. But all of them have discovered within there that man and woman and the many other beings continuously evolved from the sea, not only space, but our physical ocean. So they just put the symbol of the fish, which is the symbol of the soul, with legs. And that can mean so many different things when now you expand into seeing legs get you on land. Legs are appendages. Legs are, you know, different things. And then the fish and the snakes and the scales and all this stuff becomes of a bigger picture. And that's why then one symbol has an entire book of meanings. Like that intersecting triangular hexen, or called the Hebrew star. It's an entire book. An entire language, an entire code. And so this is how we have to approach things in 2012 if we're planning, since we've been involved in this stuff so much. I've noticed, here's another thing. Most of the people that I see are resonators, meaning that I've watched certain individuals, they're angelic resonators. Even they have the names of the angels that were given to them by their parents. It makes another reason to the meaning of why when they say that the angels came were also human, they looked like humans, but they didn't know it. That was the other thing that was explained in the Talmud, that these angels were kind of trapped in their own bodies. And because of that, and kept in and continuously seeing themselves as bodies, that's how they got trapped. So it wasn't like what we think. Sometimes we think that, you know, when there's this huge fight, and then there's weapons, and there's lasers, and there's all sorts of stuff, and then there's a chamber, and they lock everyone in there. No. It's all going on in the mind. Because even to accept those kind of stories, it has to start in the mind. So man and woman have chosen that as their story, the Orion sagas, etc. But when you say that one is trapped, it's only within the mind. Because once you fully free yourself and understand what that entails, fully freeing yourself means no fear. Fear is the pentagram. We talked about this. So to fully free yourself from the pentagram or the body, then you must have no fear. But that means that you also have to, the things that you know you need to do, like the ayahuasca, the things you know you have to brave, the jungle, the places you know you have to go and continue your mission, that your fear is preventing it. Because even in given the opportunity to, or even be able to forge forth the opportunity for yourself, noticing how you still won't do it shows you where the fear lies. And this equals your transition if you are an angel trapped inside of the human body. To go and undo much of what the ancestors have done to make this a negative experience by taking the knowledge and utilizing it for our end. You see what I mean? You got to take the knowledge and now utilize it for regeneration. Many people have taken the knowledge and much of the things that they've gotten and they've abused them. When we talk about abuse, father abusing you. So the reality is that you cannot allow the abuse to continue by stopping it in your generation, this ancestral. Some call it the gift, some call it the curse. It began with Nimrod. Zoroaster is Nimrod. Ahura Mazda is Satan. They are fire gods. His name is Ahriman. Ahri means fire. Man means earth or manna. Okay? So you can walk yourself through it if you want to prove it to yourself. It will help you, empower you to understand why you're here, how much power you really have, why you're here and how much power you really have. Meaning if you weren't able to use your power up until this point, it means because there has been possibly some misuse of the power in the past. Or at least not the knowledge of not, basically you didn't have, when you don't have the knowledge of how to use something that's already there, it means you completely know how to use it. Let me just get this really clear to people. Babies don't have to think to use their magical powers. There's no such thing as thought, or thought, who has also now been identified as the double-twined serpent, as Azazel, Mr. Etes, etc., etc., the gift and the curse, the two serpents, Iki and Enlil, the two sons from Venus, Cain and Abel, okay? It's all there, Ishmael and Israel, okay? These two guys oscillate between who is the best and who is not. Now, you notice, because one son is still in Arab countries, you see them rising up now. And to prove that they're the most just. And people are starting to feel like, you're right. Now that we went over there and tore everything up, these poor people have done nothing. Arab means father of fire. These father of fire people have done nothing. But never getting the gist of what this whole thing is about. Keeping it turning. See, the beings in the center of the earth have an interest in just keeping the whole thing going because this is their thing. But it's not the only place. And it's also, here's the other problem that took place with, or solution, because they're always bolted together, that took place within the creation of what we're calling the hybrid, which is what's running around now, the current version of man and woman. They actually became more powerful in abilities and in expanse than the beings that had created them because they were elementals. Now let me show you how this would work. Let's say, for instance, the Council of Seven fits together in order to create one human being. And each portion from the people of the Council of, or the beings from the Council of Seven is used to make those beings. Okay? Just very simple here. When they make that being, the being is more powerful because it has all seven in one, while the all seven have to be together in order to make themselves have the same power as the one that has been created. So in any event that the one that's been created decides to just fly off and go and explore different things, they can't be stopped because it would take the power of all seven forces, which are never really functioning on the same time and same season because that's what controls the times and the season, to prevent that. So this means this is a grand design. You just have to understand how it works. You have to understand and overstand how it works. And of course, verbally, it doesn't do as much justice, but visually, which is what I'm moving into now, like we're racing to get in front of the computers, to get into the movies, to get into the old programming, the old sitcoms, the old consoles, the game systems, get into those and pull out all of what I'm telling you to show you. This is exactly the role that they're playing here. This is the role play game. You need to level up. Cloud, as they say, Cloud and Sephiroth, these are the lead RPG games that have millions of people. Their top characters are Cloud, and as I explained to you before, the clouds in the sky are the Nephilim. They don't have physical bodies anymore. They just kind of hover about. And they even conflict with each other. And when there's a conflict, you see thunder. Okay? Because that is the product of their conflict. Energy. So, what happens is that you see Sephiroth, who is the inverted one. The one, even in his story, is he is the genetic modification. And he has discovered that he was genetically modified to be the greatest being. This is Sephiroth's story. But he goes through his life thinking that he is real, authentic, organic, and then figures out that he's a hybrid experiment. And this drives him nuts. And he ends up becoming the most dangerous. Sephiroth is the name of the angel, so he becomes the most dangerous angel. So these things are in the reality. It becomes very entertaining to watch this because it's not like it's just, okay, this is just another C.S. Lewis story, even though even C.S. Lewis was writing a great book of the truth. It becomes the real quest, i.e. the after quest. And it also shows you how all of this has been able to benefit you if you understand what to do with it, or to get you trapped if you don't understand what to do with it. But at least the opportunity is being placed before you now. So that's what everyone should be thinking in 2012. Like, if you want to dance around and make yourself jubilant, let it be because you received this information when it was enough time for you to make the proper adjustments that you need to make in your life to understand what your role is here in order to balance out things, not only for yourself, but also many of the other individuals that are so close to balancing, while other forces are crabs in the bucket, trying to pull the individual back through the wormhole and just put them back into this planet again. So, like I said, either way, you come back. But the reality is that you want to remain conscious. You want to keep your memories. You want to continuously expand. You don't want to reset. Okay? Reset. Look at the word. Okay? Re is the other name for the sun god Ra. Set is the other name for Satan. You don't want to reset. You've learned this lesson already. It comes to everyone. It's just a challenge. All you have to do is open yourself up abundantly to abundance. To do the best that you can to till the seed here. Meaning tend and till and take care of the seed. The children. The things that are around you. The plants. The organics. Because you are being watched on multiple levels. That's why they call them watchers. So there's nothing going on that's not being seen. So that means you don't need to have paranoia. Like, oh my goodness, I don't know if they find out that I activate. Activate. There's nothing that can be done so to you if you activate. You see what I mean? Like, just don't allow any of these hindrances. Like, is this right? Is this wrong? That playing around in 2012 is going to waste way too much time. So let's let everyone understand the message that was brought forth today. Of course, we're going to get into the other part of the show. We're going to take some questions. We're going to answer some things. But I hope I was clear enough for everyone to understand exactly what's happening here. I'm going to definitely be bringing out more information on this. I'm going to let Wes come in, and he's going to talk to you about, he's going to talk to everyone just about, you know, what he has to say. And also, Crystal, I'm sure, is going to chime in on some things. I'm going to check out and see if I can find Luis. And also, I'm just going to remind Wes to talk about this pay-for-product campaign, which is actually the resistance making another effort for people who have a skill or something that can be utilized in conjunction with the resistance to get products if they haven't had the finances and things to get those products by rendering their skill. So this makes it a much more fluid system of current. So, Wes, can you hear me out there?
I sure can. Sevan, how are you?
Oh, exceptionally well. I mean, I feel great these days. It's just a lot of energy coming across, a lot of empowering messages, and it's really got real. Like, I think on that Bad Boys episode, he says, man, it's just got real. It's really like that. It's at this point, we really see exactly how it's all playing out. There's no fear. We have definitely a connection with so many higher advanced intelligent beings, and that's why there's just the ignorance that must be overcome, and so that's what we're up to.
I absolutely agree, and, you know, I was, in terms of what the resistance is really doing right now, it's just amazing. What we really want to do is just make it more cohesive, And, you know, I was talking to my friend Scotty, who's on, as well, and, you know, we were going, wow, we really like it, it's so expansive, and there's so much going on, but it gets to be a little confusing, for some that maybe are new members and get there and kind of don't know where to start. So, you know, what we're really trying to do right now is make it more cohesive and make it, link up a lot better, so it can kind of take you through the journey of, you know, being that one that's, you know, never heard of any esoteric knowledge, to somebody, you know, all the way to an adept. You know, and I think that right now when we talked about the help, for anybody that can help out if they have a specific skill, you know, if they can do graphic design or, AutoCAD programmers or just anything. I mean, you know, if you even think that you can do something, just, let us know what that is. And again, it doesn't have to be a money situation changing hands. If you're looking to obviously level up to take things to the next level, you know, there's plenty of things that the resistance can offer you in terms of supplements, Ethereum Gold, Altura, Ethereum Black, Shilajit, lots of things that can be given. And all that's needed is just, you know, the time, to trade the time, you know, for you to help out the resistance with helping us take this whole design to the next level. You know, we have a really exciting game coming out, Astral Quest, and it's basically one of these real type life systems that, you know, I don't know about you, but I've played games before, and you kind of really get nowhere except from an entertainment standpoint, but this is actually the first type of system I think that's ever been developed where you'll actually be able to be the game and take yourself on a quest from, you know, going from one level to the next and to the next beyond that until you actually level up for real in real life and get to the, you know, the basic end game that we're all seeking, and that's to be the enlightened adept. So, you know, really just kind of making this whole process more cohesive and, you know, coming to the resistance aids right now and talking to Sevan or myself, or whole and, you know, just really seeing if you can offer something to, you know, make this idea more palatable. You know, we're getting to the point now where we really need to get in the game and make it happen. And, you know, if we all band together, at least one, every single one of us has something that we can offer, you know, a positive, a time, everything. So it's just a matter of, you know, getting together and talking about that and seeing who can do what and then going from there.
For sure, for sure. So, I mean, just to make it clear to everyone, if you have some graphical skills, that's like we're looking for people who know how to do graphics, we're going to be sorting out a lot of things. If you have some CSS skills, we're going to be completely redoing the resistance like we're in there now. I want to thank also resistance member Poetic Needles, Joseph. I mean, he's just been awesome. We just got a chance to get from him the 1,400 posts that are on the resistance, all the links to those posts. And so what we're going to be doing is we're going to be cleaning out things. We're also going to be deleting some stuff so people may get some emails of some posts that we didn't feel were relevant, especially to what's going on now, or didn't contain the proper content, and maybe getting those posts back, because what we're going to do is we're going to remove all the posts that are not correct, and we're going to also link within the posts that have been developed. Every time there's a keyword brought up, we're going to link that in with the complete definition of that word and that being or whatever we're speaking on, so that way it makes it really easy for a person to go through some of the more expansive documents that contain a lot of in-depth knowledge, but to be able to walk it step by step so that the person really becomes, well, the resistance itself and the information that's there is really becoming the information source to Astral Quest, because it allows, while the person is on the quest, to access actual, real-time, organic information about what they're experiencing rather than some simulation. So, I'm going to also bring Louise in. He just notified me that he's actually on the line, so I do have his line open. Louise, what's going on, brother?
Honest, everybody. Everything's good. I'm just here listening to the show.
Awesome. Can you hear? Yes, we can hear you loud and clear.
Okay.
Okay. All right. So we're going to go ahead and start taking some questions. So if a person, if you're calling in today, you can press 1. If you need the call-in number, it is area code 347-996-5688. Of course, this is the angelic disclosure, so it's, you know, if you want to keep it relative to the topic, that's great. Or if you want to talk about cleansing, you want to talk about other stuff, that's also fine. But this is the perfect time to call in, ask your question. If you need some information in regards to what I'm presenting now, or if you need some information about something that I talked about last week, then we can go ahead and get into that. Also, Crystal or Wes, have you had a chance to look into the chat box to see if there have been any questions in there? Do you want me to take a call and then give you some time to look through there? Get those questions lined up, because I think there's a few questions in the chat box, and then we'll probably need a moment to get those questions lined up. So if you could do that for me, Wes or Crystal, that would be great. And then we can get those questions answered, the people who typed them in the chat box. And so right now, we're going to go ahead and take a question from a caller from the area code 202. Caller, you're on the 2012 show. What can we talk
about? Wholeness. Wholeness and balance. As always, thank you for what you do, because it inspires me. My question is exactly this. What is the relationship of consciousness to the crystal nature of existence? Like the crystalline nature of existence. That's my question.
Okay, great question. Actually, because there is basically a level to this, it is as above, so below nature to everything, meaning that there is a correspondence to the essence of our thoughts, all the way up to, from them being crystals, from them being clouds, to them being actual living entities. Even us as ourselves, that's what they call it, min, because min means mind anyway, as in even the word mint, which is, mint also means mind. So what you're dealing with the crystal world, is there's an entire crystal kingdom that corresponds to our world also, that's just glass, basically. And so there are, of course, crystals that are, if you're going to do the positive and negative thing, there's crystals that emit the exact opposite of another crystal. Let's just put it like that. And in addition to that, there's also meteorites. So what you have is that the crystalline nature of our consciousness is redundified within the crystalline field that is inside of our planet. And on top of that, what they say is that because there's a compression of this kind of fire within the center of the Earth, then what you go through is about 30 miles of burning sand, which is basically in the state of glass or crystal at this point. And so that's really the relationship between our consciousness and the crystalline network that actually exists and can be seen even with the physical eye in our planet.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Does that make sense for you? I mean, is that crystal clear?
I always have to re-listen to everything, but silicone found in the body naturally.
Yeah, but see, what happens is that if you notice when you go and look up what is a crystal made out of, you'll find it's made out of nothing but silicones, carbons, different minerals, and different gases that are emitted during certain temperatures of heat, and then that determines what color it comes out in the geometric structure, etc. So really, it's like when you're dealing with silicone, you're dealing with like the base element to making glass. As sand, when you heat up sand, it makes glass. So
my question is I'm thinking more at the point where light becomes dense enough to become matter, you know, what is that first substance that it becomes? That's what I was thinking about.
Well, they say that it's like a sand, because that's what Ethereum gold is. Ethereum gold, what we provide on the site, is basically when they did the test on it. And you can even call the guy that Patrick, who owns the company, that when they did a test on it, that when it was sent to the laboratory, because they thought, basically the story between it about the Ethereum gold is that they thought that it was actually a plant that was curing cancer. There was a lady who started curing cancer with this plant. And when it was finally heard by the guy who started the Ethereum Gold Company or Harmonic Enterprise, he heard from like 3 different sources about this lady, so he took it upon himself to go visit the lady. And when he met the lady, he found that, you know, there was alarming properties within this plant that she was using, And he also thought, he also found out that the plant hadn't been classified yet, so he thought that that was the conspiracy. And so he put a lot of work into getting the plant registered and then starting to work with trials to see if the plant could cure cancer, and it showed that it couldn't. After several trials, they were saying they showed that it couldn't cure cancer. So what ended up happening was that he said about 6 or 7 months rolled into it, and he got a call back from a place that he had submitted. Actually, he got a call from the lady, He got a call from the lady, and she said, oh, I did forget to tell you that the where the plant is growing is in some white sand, which is kind of odd, too. And he said it kind of clicked for him then. He had her send him the sand. He sent the sand immediately to the laboratory. And then he said that the guy, of the head of the lab, called in immediately and asked them probing questions about it. And then didn't reveal anything. He just told me, hey, I'll call you back. And then he said it took him about 4 months, and he even called the guy several times. The guy wouldn't take his call, et cetera. And then finally, about 7 months later, the guy just calls him out of the blue, almost when he forgot about it entirely. And he said, the reason why I didn't want to call you back is because I didn't know how you were going to take it, but the reason why our lab is more advanced is because we do a lot of the testing for different elements for mining, like with the big-time firms, when they go in to mine something, they can tell by the minerals that are in the ground what's really down there. So when we tested your sand, we found that it is in the first state that matter turns into once it's translated into energy, once the energy is translated into mass. And so because it's this white sand, it would lead me to the conclusion that white sand is the first state that you would enter into. And it really works right on the spiritual level, that the jinn or the genie were in the desert, within the sand, etc. So then they would put the sand in a bottle, and then they would seal it with the seal of Solomon's ring, as they were saying, which is really the evocation ring itself. And then they would take it, and that became the story of the genie or the genius, because they would get smarter off of these beings that were elementals, Nephilim, because they had already been to space, and they had space knowledge. And that's what the Theosophical Society says, is that the Theosophy was set up in space first, and they talked about the knowledge of celestial bodies and within the brotherhoods and sisterhoods of light. And then with the ones that rebelled, came to Earth, they did it because they had gained enough knowledge to basically create their own world. And when they came to this world to do that, I guess they figured out in the long run that it was much more difficult than they anticipated, because now you have, and that's also why you see that God has a problem, not the Most High, it has a problem with dealing with its rebellious children. Have you ever noticed that God is all playing out anyway? Like, when you sit there and really compress the whole story, like, well, why is it all playing out anyway? Why would there be the necessity to play out an entire circular school, basically, to rehabilitate bad kids, basically? Because any other reason wouldn't make any sense. Because if God was putting everyone through a test, and just destroy everything and get on with it, God don't waste time. Most High doesn't waste time. But if it was a training
module,
turn these beings over and over and over until they got sick of what they were doing. Like, this is also what happens if you look at the movie The Talented Mr. Ripley. It tells you right in the movie, the rich say that the money is almost like a curse to them. They've grown to loathe it, because you can't go anywhere. Always someone's trying to kidnap you. You have an extreme phobia. You generally become hooked to the caudacious drugs early, like the Ritalin, all the different stuff that they give those kids, because they do have a connection. And so this is the thing, man. It's like I said, when we explore this more, we always get to the bottom and the top of exactly what's happening, because that's how this whole thing is put together. So hopefully that gives you a little bit more clarity about that crystalline nature. It also exists within the organs, and that's why there's a crystal that corresponds to each of the organs in your body. There was a breastplate that was worn by the high priest, which consisted of the 12 crystals, or the 12 essences that would be needed to actually control the 12 tribes of the world. And the name that was written underneath that was a tetragrammaton, which was said to power the entire crystal set that was sitting on as the breastplate. The tetragrammaton has an ability as a mantra to turn the body into a higher vibration. However, the channel is controlled. It is controlled by none other than Orion itself. Like, because, just as Dan Winter already pointed out, the actual symbolism in the hourglass of the tetragrammaton itself is the same symbolism of Orion, which looks like an hourglass, but in an obtuse shape. So that's really what we're talking about here.
I mean, for me, because, like, pretty much every moment I can tell that I'm affecting things around me. I mean, it just It starts to get funny. It makes me laugh because I know I'm affecting the environment around me. So I'm trying to understand, all right, if I think I'm thinking a thought quietly, it's like it's never quiet to me because it's always manifesting and I'm always manifesting everything. So it's like, yeah, okay, I jumped. I know I did. All right. You know, but how do I take the reins at this point where, you know, I keep seeking things new and I keep wanting everything new. I keep searching out new stuff. So it's like, all right, that's what I do. I'm just trying to focus.
Well, yeah, I mean, I know exactly what you're saying. It's like paranormal rehab time for many people. I always call the resistance Kabbalist rehab or paranormal junkie rehab, which is just always expecting something to happen in order for it to confirm that you've reached the next level. Never understanding how to fit in your position, meaning that sit in yourself, they say the seat of your soul, and actually start working the thing now that you've graduated to such a grand state in the environment itself. It keeps the mind from spinning because you understand that you can transcend mind and soul, but it will show if you still have a problem with body if it doesn't manifest on the physical plane. And that's what they were saying, that the whole idea of this entire thing was for us to be able to take these grand ideas. Because they also say what the Nephilim are, they are the struggles. That's what they call them, the strugglers and the hinders. They are the struggles that produce great fruit. You see, the toiling and the tilling in the field that end up producing great fruit.
Say that last piece again.
They're the struggle. They're struggling. They're the strugglers, meaning that when you say that I'm struggling, the energy and the feeling behind that is an archon or a Nephilim, meaning that the compressed energy itself, if you wanted to try to find it, you would find it within the archon itself. It would be completely embodying it. And that's what I was saying. You would have a group of them, and they say there's 13 of them, that there would be a group of them, and they would each hold one particular energy that would have to do with our struggles. And this is why they call it the wheel of life, because it's really the zodiac. And each archon takes on the form of a beast. But then, each beast has these positive and negative sides to it. You see what I mean? And so, this is like, it's a gauntlet. And this is just how it was designed. Like, all I'm doing is just explaining how it was designed. I didn't say I designed it.
Right.
I didn't say that we should worship. I didn't say any of that. My goal is to completely become non-biased. Look at the word. Bias means you're, I won't even tell people what that word means right now, but non-biased means to not be in a certain state. And that means basically to not be, when you tell people knowledge, you want to remove as much of your judgment from it. Because it allows it to become clear to them what you're saying. The more judgment you put on it, the more it becomes difficult for them to understand what you're saying because they also have to feel the same way. You see what I mean? Like they also have to judge at that moment that what you're saying is exactly the way that they perceive it. And when you talk to an individual on the opposite zodiac of you, it's never going to appear that way. And this is why most knowledge that's coming out now is not universal. We're getting into universal knowledge by removing the judgment from this information and just providing people with the information of the truth. The truth is universal. It ceases to become universal once one writes what was the good part and what was the bad part. You see what I mean? Because
I also notice that when I give energy to people, I notice that it's almost like a swap. Just certain situations have happened recently where I know that the person may have been in a particular mind state, I interact with them, and they change, and they go away happy, and I go away feeling indifferent, and I say, okay, well, I transmute the energy. And it's happened at least 3 times where I've noticed, and I guess I've observed the experience that it happened. So I noticed a particular experience, but I also feel like I have a duty to interact with certain situations to neutralize them. Whereas it's like I'm bringing them out anyway. You know what I mean? It's like I walk into the room and things are charged, and I say a particular phrase, and then the whole situation escalates. I can't even say it's crazy. It's just like, all right, that's what I'm calibrated for, but I'm just trying to become a better instrument. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean, and we all are. I mean, all of us want to be. It's really the tuning. We want to be able to find. We're already an instrument in the tent that we're playing in an orchestra. And we have the harmonic spheres within us and the organs, and we just want to tune properly and not be out of tune. So it's almost like there is a point within all these energies that is the pinnacle of their existence. We can reach the pinnacle on all scales and remain there. This is our ability. And that's what I was saying. This is why it's not from a power level, like from a power level how we see it, like brute force. And that's really the Nephilim, they're about brute force. So when it comes to arm wrestling the Nephilim, forget about it. The reality is that it's because of our other abilities to outthink, outwit. Our will, which is being, has been broken. The world's will has been broken, which is why they have suffered the hypnosis of the Archons and their Sharon Lock gaze that they've been placing on everyone. Hypnotism. You see? And now they got a third eye. Hypnosis, which is the TV. One eye there. One bright screen on a cathode ray tube, which is a hexagram. Multiple hexagrams for programming. It, opening up more panels within the person's brain. So the reality is that it's all here, but what, as far as the information, but you could grow so much from knowing this. That's what I'm saying. Like, if people could stop focusing basically on the downside or the upside of what I'm saying and just imagine how much they're growing because they know how this stuff works, that's what, because the spirit already accepts it. Once you can explain to the spirit the truth, it understands it. It's going to take your body maybe some time. But the spirit only needs to see a reflection of the real truth one time before it knows how to correct itself. And that's what's happening also. Many people are correcting themselves. As many people are spinning out of control, there's others that are correcting themselves. And so we want to line up and we want to allow others to line up for this, because what's happening is galactic lineup. Now look at the system of the chakras itself. Many people will notice that some of them are in line, but some of them aren't. This is the other thing that I haven't yet got into, is why the chakras are not in a straight line. Many graphs depict them as in a straight line, but those graphs are completely incorrect. The chakras are in the position of the organ, and then they link back into the spine. So could that, them not being straight up and down, like all of our organs in one line,
right,
or maybe not even organs at all, be the exact symbol of where the disharmonics are? Because obviously it's disharmonic when you look at the reality. It's not, it doesn't take a genius to see that there are some things that are offline. But is it offline, and that's also redundifying on our physical body, as our physical body appears to be offline too, and only using one side of itself most of the time. You see?
But
go ahead.
To me it always seems like a beautiful struggle. It's bittersweet, and it's like, there have been times where I felt like crazy for laughing at crazy situations, because it's like, well, at least I know what's going on. I'm calibrated. I know what to do with this. You know what I mean? But it's the situations where, for me, I know I have to take a step forward, and I'm going to take the step forward, but it's being, you know, it's being whole as I do it so that I can fully be in that moment.
But you still have to remember, this is a vivid thing. Like, if you, like, there's a lot of, especially the Buddhist teachings, the Deepak Chopra teachings, the Tibetan teachings, and they're really subtle. And they speak a great deal on the mind and the spirit, because the mind and the spirit are still two subtle forces. The body, and our mastering the beast, again, is what the highest level of initiates were attempting to do. They were trying to navigate the abyss, or what they did call also Leviathan, which still seems to be a symbol for what the earth is in itself. But it shows you that in our reality that there's another level that shows you when you ultimately master things, and it plays out in front of you. You see what I mean? Rather than it's in the dream or it's in how you feel, it's also in the actual environment around you. And the only way to change a disenvironment is to push out the frequency. Now, if you push out, let's say, the human resonance is at 7.8 hertz. The oscillating between 7 to 13.8 hertz. Now, anything in frequency, you understand, 13 and 7 hertz are very loud frequencies. That they're not like their other higher octave correspondents. Let's say 23,000 hertz, you can't hear.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So what happens in the physical reality, even if you're this high mind, high spiritual being pumping out 21,000 hertz at a 7 hertz being, they're not going to feel that. You need to come to your corresponding octave in the same region as them. And this is why the radio only plays between a certain, I think it's 88.1, and 106.9, I believe, or 107.1. It only plays in that range because that's the entire octave. It doesn't need to go 20,000.1. And then what they play across the radio, notice 105.9 is always occupied wherever you go with BS, basically. They make sure because it hits a certain part in your system. And then when it hits that part in the system, it sends the elf wave in. And then thus, what happens is what the Arabs used to speak against all the time, Udubillahi minallah shaitan rajim, meaning God protect us from the whispers of shaitan. The whispers of shaitan now are not as mystical as it was before. Now, sometimes a simple typing and message over an iPhone. You see? So we have to be able to adjust to how it's changing, because that's what allows us, why we're, when we're spinning out of control, to see exactly where you are. Now again, this is still mind soul stuff. When you deal with the body, which is you go, you cleanse it, it has no choice but to change frequency. It's not its choice anymore. See, most people don't understand that the enemies at times, if you want to give them the term, are the mind and the soul, what they've been made into through the suggestions back and forth between one another. So what happens is that if you gain control over the body, you can gain control over the mind and the mind and the soul. At any point, you can gain control, basically. You grab the soul, you can gain control of the body and the mind. If you grab the mind, you can gain control of the soul and the body, and so forth, you see? So it's just about getting control over one of those axes on that triangle and getting that field, basically, what you would call it, if you took a tire in to get it balanced, okay? So it can go faster. Because what happens is when your tires are off of balance, you sit in a Ferrari. Your tires are going, if your tires are unbalanced, you can actually feel the wobbling, one, but you can't get top speed, and you will also blow that tire before top speed. So what happens is if to balance the wheel, you take it in, you put the right proper weight in the proper area. This means that you have to know how much mercury you need, how much Venus you need, how much soul you need. You have to know those, that balance, and you have to get that alchemy mercury right. Then once it's right and it clicks, it turns on the system. Now, there are different ways to do this. That's why there's so many systems of teachings, at least when they were telling the truth. There were so many systems of teaching, but it was all about more ways to do the same thing, to turn the vehicle back on. Now we're dealing with the actual religious system that says to turn it on is the highest evil of wickedness and antichrist, anti-everything. Meaning that Christianity and Islam teach that if a human is to exercise their power on this dimension, then, and Catholicism, about to get them, they should be condemned. So this is where it's all going to end up coming to a head, is the people who believe that versus the people who don't believe that. Like I was saying before, now they have people they're saying to upgrade the brain. They're trying to find ways to upgrade the brain. So now there's this new organization that is formed that is against this organization to upgrade the brain. But how this looks to a person in the Arabah or on the keter of their mind, they see it as, okay, so basically in a nutshell, it's okay to do things that destroy your brain, i.e. alcohol and all the rest of the stuff, but when it comes to enhancing the brain, that's banned. And we should get hundreds of people to sign a petition to stop this. You see? So on both ends, it's silly. And this is what happens when one begins to focus on the wrong things rather than the vivid level of experience. And in this reality, if we're not getting that vivid experience, target the body. Go ahead and start shooting your, what do they call that, flaming arrows into those parts of your body and get that thing cleaned out. Understand how much mucoid plaque is built up in the intestines. Understand exactly why the crystals, when laying them on the chakras, teach the chakra again what it was like to be harmonic. This was why there's a crystal for every chakra. And so this is how you repair the junk DNA or junk information. DNA is only information. The junk information that has been placed in your body in order to turn off your actual DNA stream. And of course, that's what powers you up, is to turn those switches, which are basically binary. When you lose duality, it stops short-circuiting the calypsum, the corpus callosum in the center of the brain, which you can see is burned out now. Meaning that if you look at a person's corpus callosum, very few electrodes fire between that area of the brain. That's called the bridge. So the bridge is broken. And when the bridge is reconnected, which means it has to be basically infused with energy, you have to shoot a spark up there, basically. And that's where Kundalini comes in. And this is also why Kundalini gets demonized, because it does give the ability of the individual to hit a superhuman state. But I will tell individuals, it can't be reached with thinking that you're going to become this all-powerful, chronicle-like being that's going to throw cars at everyone. The Men in Black will neutralize you so fast, meaning there are forces here that neutralize individuals that have ideas of using this power for negativity. That is at least the level of control that they put on it now. So things would have already been out of control with the atom bomb. Remember, the individuals who made the atom bomb, Jack Parsons, Elias Crowley, up in the mansion over there by Loch Ness, evoking AWOS, bought in an interdimensional being through the Enochian knowledge and the information that was not supposed to fall into their hands after Hitler went into Nazi Germany and marched with Ubermensch, super soldiers, running on magnetics, meaning they don't get tired, through the Balkan Mountains in order to obtain the knowledge of how to activate the light body, then bought that knowledge back into the faction that we call the United Nations now, which formed itself through Lucis Trust and the rest of the organizations that are pushing the Luciferian movement through the world, because they know they're angels here. That's what they're doing this for. They want to control angels. That's their thing. They know how powerful hybrids are. And they just want to keep it under control. And so there are other forces that are outside of this that these hybrids, quote unquote, connect to that are not negative forces. The reason why people have a hard time contacting them is because they remain most of the time on the frequency of the controllers. So when they move and shift their frequency, which is what Ethereum Gold does. It takes you out of this disharmonic spectrum and puts you in a harmonic electromagnetic spectrum all the time. That's why you can't just use it for 2 weeks. This is 2012. If you could do it all the time, at least until you feel the adjustment and you know you can hold that adjustment. These things train the body. They're non-binding, like meaning when you want to smoke weed, again, you want to smoke. It's a binding drug. It has binded to the cell. DMT is not like that. You don't feel like you're ready to go and do another DMT adventure. You feel more like you're kind of obligated. So at some point, you're going to do it. But the reality is that things that bind are one thing, the drug, what drags you through things, what lays on the floor, because it's a D rug, meaning D means the half of a circle, which is divided, meaning, or the D man, the divided man. So a D rug is basically something that you lay on the ground that is divided in itself, which shows you how low it can really be. So these are drugs. But when you're talking about herbs, the plants, what exists here on the planet, then you can pull the etymology about how those herbs are feminine. There's her in herb. I mean, it's not rocket science. But that's also why it's her in Hermes. And that's why Hermes is an androgynous. He's not a male. It's a male-female. So it's talking about other beings who also have this information about the double-twined serpent or the Kundalini force. And they have been using it. And their level of control, this is where the resistance comes in, because what my intentions are is for them to no longer have control over who does and who does not use it. Because I know that the Most High can govern anyone who does or does not use it. Meaning that the power of who gets it and who doesn't get it should not be in their hands. It's no different than what you see going on in Israel right now with those Ashkenazi, Khazar, Mongolians that are there. That they have the knowledge, but they cannot use it. Their bodies can't hold it. And so this is the continuous plight because, again, this energy was supposed to be used to rejuvenate our planet and to get it to its next state of consciousness. So the controllers that now are bottlenecking it, which is why they're going to be removed. They will be ejected from here because anytime you hold back something and you're standing in front of it, when it finally blows, what happens to you? You get propelled out somewhere. So do you see how even with them, they propel their existence by locking other beings inside of hermetic jars or dimensions, spheres, bubbles, until they crack. And then that explosion in itself thrusts life, or basically ejects life back into the ocean again, but in a higher level of existence. And then it creates a bubble around itself again. Like I said, people are not even getting close these days to what is really going on because they won't go on the journey. But they play like they go on the journey. I'm talking to Carrie Cassidy. I'm talking to many of these individuals. They won't go on the real journey. And this is why they cannot bring information about what we're to do in 2012. And so thus we'll do it. We'll do it as much as we can. We'll take care of business. We will deliver. And that's what we're here for. If the resistance wasn't going to be here to allow people to transcend and do what they needed to do, we wouldn't even have this show today. Because there's enough in this show, as we do pretty much within every show, to get an individual to understand exactly what's going on. So we got about 8 more minutes left in the call, brother. We're going to go ahead and take one more caller that is called in.
Oh, thank you.
Man, thank definitely you, I thank you, too, for inspiring this level of conversation today. It's always a joy.
I'll see you when I see you.
Definitely.
Thank
okay,
you.
So we're going to go ahead and take the caller from area code 512. Let me open the line. Okay, caller, you're on the 2012 show.
Yeah, blessings. I'm Dave.
Good day, Dave.
Man, I'll tell you what. It's just overwhelming fear. Comes at me constantly. I'm lost in it. I've been a musician all my life, professional musician. My daughter's 9 years old. When she was brought into this world, I just didn't want to play music anymore. I'm lost in the monetary issue. It's like, you know, I talk to people and tell them the truth about what's going on in the room. I walk away feeling bad. I'm a super, super empath. And I'm just overwhelmed by it.
Okay, I mean, well, let's speak really directly. What is it that you really need to understand about the monetary issue? Because you can see it's pretty vast. It's from, you know, people having a hard time making money to people not understanding what money really is to all-out abuse of money and even magic on money. So what is it that what is it directly that really disturbs you when you have these conversations with people?
You know, it's not about a specific. It's an energetics that I walk away from. You know, it's as if I've been like this Jesus story. I walk into the trading post and I raise hell, and I don't like to do it any longer.
Okay, I see what you mean, and it also does happen. If, of course, this is really elation. What happens at times is when becoming to the point where you can see what's going on, which means you would have to be on top of it. People have to understand how dimensions really work is for you to see entirely what's going on. You can only do that from like a bird's eye view. Because you're standing in front, there's a limitation of how far you can see. And it's mainly because of what's directly in front of you. So when we enter this state where we begin to see what's going on, it's higher. And then at times, we want to come down like Moses from the mountain and then tell everyone that they should stop worshiping the golden calf, which is, of course, a symbolism of materialism. And what happens is that we're being challenged to see if the message itself can metamorphosize into something that is adaptable for them to do, meaning that as an empath, being able to tap completely into the individual's energy to understand in their life the file that can't be accessed, as we talk about, the life is an anagram for a file, that inside of that file is information that needs to be known about them in order for it to click for them.
You know, I got that, and I do that very, very well. The problem is I walk away feeling dirty.
Okay,
I walk away feeling fearful. It takes something away from me. I don't understand that part.
Well, it has to be in the message that's being presented by yourself. Like, again, it's also how we're looking at this information. Like, if we're looking at it as, again, something that cannot empower us and has trapped us, then we've missed the entire meaning of the message entirely. Like, you got to realize that when you talk to a person and you give them information that is the truth, if it's the truth, because when you also give other information that is not the truth, it will have the effect of leaving one basically feeling like they've not told the truth, which is a negative feeling. But the truth always has positive associated with it. So you have to look directly at the message and what you're getting across and why you're getting it across. So it's sometimes not in so much as what it's the technique. It's like what is exactly really coming across to these individuals in what you're saying, because you may work better in an entirely different arena and placing yourself in the arena of giving them message, and that's not really your specialty. It may not be how you give, because here's one thing I'll let you know.
Well, that's exactly what I'm dealing with. I'm lost in what I'm to do. Where's my positioning on that?
What happens is, especially as a musician, you use the instrument to express who you are. When you use your voice have you ever gotten really, really into the state and really connection to your music, and then the phone rings, and then you have to have this conversation, and you're talking, and you can feel the energy coming out. You may not even be talking about spirituality or any of that. You're just having a conversation, but you watch yourself basically begin to descend, and you come out of the zone, because basically you have to change frequency. So what happens with us is that when we're doing certain roles where that's not exactly how our tune, that's not how we play, basically, then we run the risk of being just like if you're a saxophone player and then now you're going in there trying to play violin. You don't even have the same notes. So this is also what is key, is to understand what is our real ability to work with this level of consciousness and then get with others that are doing the other part, meaning that you have some people that are really the mouth, meaning that they can talk and talk and talk and talk. And I'm not talking about anyone directly, but they can talk and talk and talk. And then you have other individuals that they get bored with talking. They rather play the soundtrack. Like look at what a movie exists with. You don't find the people that are doing in the orchestra also running across the screen and acting in the whole thing. Someone's doing the music, but is the music not just important? Like a person that thinks the music is important, convert a movie into a WAV file or an MP3 and then just listen to it and then see that the entire movie is music. Because if they remove the music from the movie, the whole impression of the movie is changed. So this is what I mean. We're manning a ship, the Earth itself, but we have to man our stations. And like I said, some people want to be the pilot, but they don't realize that the pilot is not the captain. So they are even just in wanting to drive the ship in the desperation of wanting to lead everyone have forgot that that's not even the lead role. So this is what we have to work with, and we work with this together. So what I would encourage you to do is to, when you said that you were playing music, when you say what your skill is, because everyone knows what their skill is, especially as you cross into the, after 25, 26, these areas, you know what your skill is, your strong point. Utilize figuring out how your strong point is going to mesh in to getting the overall effect that you want to from society. That way you don't get your energy removed, because you don't want this to become vampiric. And it has a potential to become vampiric. Many individuals in not understanding how to channel the energy properly, even myself. I remember about a year and a half ago, around the December time, I almost experienced a death in my own body. And I talked about this last show, because I had too much mean energy, because I was internalizing too much of this and not seeing exactly the positive level of it and always drilling in just what was going on to everyone. And sure, that benefited people, but did it benefit me? Just like you were saying, if you walk away drained, you don't want to walk away from the conversation like that. So unfortunately, there's only 40 more seconds left in the call. I did want to let everyone know, just thank everyone for calling in. There, of course, we're not going to go into the continuation of the call, because it does click off for everyone that's in the chat room. But I think we got a lot of information out today. And like I said, sir, I would definitely encourage you to look at the Voltron pattern, meaning that even the leg, if the head, who is not the leader, but if a person thinks that the head is the leader and the leader needs to go somewhere, it cannot walk because it doesn't have a leg. So each person or needs to grab something, but it cannot grab because it doesn't have an arm. So what it really tells us is that the leader is all of us, that we're to lead this message into the future so that we can get everyone whole. Like I said, I want to say wholeness and balanced vibration to everyone again, and fortunately we're just going to have to continue next week on the 2012 show, and of course we'll have some very, very interesting things to tell you then. Wholeness.